We're going to show two very short video stories about women improving their health and their economic opportunities through clean energy. And the first is going to come from Solar Sister, and the second video will come from the Global Alliance for Clean Cookstoves. And there are two other films listed on your resource sheet, and I encourage you to go check those out. We're not going to show them today, but they're definitely worth watching. And one of them that's listed there is actually also available in the lobby. You're welcome to take this DVD, which is our collection of three short documentary films that the Wilson Center made about the connections between people and their environment. I hope you'll pick that up. Francesca?
Kwa jina naitwa Adija Alibali, mimi ni mjasiriamali kwa Solar Sister, ninaishi Kijaneda. Nje ya shughuli zangu na Solar Sister, mimi ni mwalimu wa vikundi na pia ni mkulima. Yani kwa kifupi tu kwamba kijiji hiki sana sana ni wakulima. Wafugaji ni wafugaji wadogo wadogo tu, lakini sana sana ni wakulima. Nijibwe. Kwa kweli jua ni zuri. Matumizi ya jua yako mengi. Jua kwanza likiwaka tunapata mwanga. Jua pia likipiga kwenye mmea, mmea unastawi. Pia jua likiwaka linatuletea mvua. Kipato tunachokipata kwanza asilimia kubwa tunaweka kwa ajili ya chakula. Sasa tukitoka kwenye chakula pale kinachobakia kidogo labda matibabu kwa sababu tunakuwa sasa hiyo na bima ya afya ndiko inakoishia hapo. Basi na peleka watoto shuleni. Na mavazi kidogo mara moja kwa mwaka. Kikisha kuja kwa mara moja kikipita basi na ndio maana tuna. Kwa kweli mimi nilipenda kuwa Solar Sister kwa sababu sehemu hii ya huku kwetu haina mwanga na tayari ikifika jioni kila eneo hapa linakuwa na mwanga kupitia Solar Sister. Kwa sababu kwanza kabisa tulikuwa tunatumia vibatari, alafu bei ya mafuta kila siku inapanda. Na vile vibatari kwa sababu sasa hivi ni hatari, vinaweza vikaripuka, vikaunguza nyumba. Kingine hata ule moshi unapojaa koroboi pale, yale moshi macho yanakuwa mekundu, kifua kinajaa. Alafu watoto wa shule walikuwa wanashindwa kusoma na kibatari, lakini hii Solar Sister inasaidia watoto wa shule kusoma usiku. Ina maana ile hela ambayo wangenua mafuta taa kila wiki wanaikusanya pale kwenye sanduku ni ndogo, 1500, 2500, mwisho 5500. Kwa hiyo pale akibahatisha kikusanya hapo, basi baada ya muda basi ile ile tunakopeshana. Ndio tunaenda shambani. Sana sana mimi nategemea hiki kitongoji hiki kwa baadaye. Nilitegemea hapa ningepata shule, nipate dispensary kwa sababu tunafuata matibabu mbali. Najisikia vizuri kwa sababu hata mimi pamoja na kubaki kuwa mwalimu wale masanduku, nilikuwa nahitaji watu wapate maendeleo madogo madogo ili nahitaji maendeleo. Maendeleo ya kwanza kabisa niliofuna faulu nje na kujiwekea fedha ni mwanga. Na maana maendeleo ya kwanza ni mwanga.
My name is Sarah Ruba. I was young when my mother died and one of my sisters died of lung cancer. Sometimes I ask myself, what is my life about? I've seen terrible things. There are still scars most anywhere you look. The bush where we used to play hide and seek, the drought has destroyed it. The smoke from cooking affects us. The old stoves, that is just the way they are. They make this world black. They also make us black inside. But this new stove, look at this with your eyes. I learned of this clean cook stove 2 years ago. There is less smoke, and it uses much less fuel. The firewood I used in a week, it now lasts for a month. There was nothing good or enjoyable going for firewood. There are so many things we can do now instead. We can help our children in school, visit our elders, or help the sick. I even set up a shop to improve myself. I want to pass on something better to my children, so they are safe, so they have opportunities. If it was my wish, everyone would have a clean cook stove. To one who has seen this hard life, it is difficult to explain why things are this way. But this is my life, and I have every reason to be happy.
Nearly half the planet cooks over an open fire. The smoke from the basic act of cooking kills nearly 2 million people each year. Most of the victims are women and children. Help us achieve our goal of 100 million clean cook stoves by 2020.
Thank you. Now ask the panelists for panel three to come up, please. And thank you all for watching all these stories. It's been tremendous to hear the voices of women. And I think back to what Suzanne Ehler said earlier about the question of invisibility. And you know, if maybe it's not that people don't have a voice, it's that we're not listening to them. And I think it's great that we've spent some time today listening to those voices. Thank you. And now I'll turn it over to Maggie.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here. My name is Maggie Roth, and I am the communications officer for the International Union for Conservation of Nature's Global Gender Office. And I'm really excited to be here, and I'm really excited to be joined by my distinguished panelists. And I want to thank the Wilson Center first and foremost for having me. So as a communicator, I strive to always back my stories up with evidence. And so we've heard some really incredible and powerful stories and anecdotes about climate change and about women. We know that climate change affects all sectors. It impacts food security, health, nutrition, biodiversity, migration. And we also know that women are disproportionately affected by climate change. Suzanne asked a really great question in the last panel when she asked what these international agreements and negotiations, what kind of impact they're having, particularly on the local level. And we think about this a lot at IUCN as well. And Lorena Aguilar, who leads the Global Gender Office, she was in Nepal working with a community. And one of the community members came up to her, a woman came up to her and said, this is great. These negotiations, these big meetings in big cities that I can't get to, great. But what does that mean for me? How does that affect me? And Lorena had to think about it, and she said, you know, I don't know, but I'm going to find out. And from that, the Environment and Gender Index was born. And then kind of that has evolved into what we're now calling the Environment and Gender Information Platform, where we strive to create data sets that really shed light on women and gender equality in the environmental arena. And so I just want to share with you a little bit of data from our EGI that I think really provides the evidence to kind of back up a lot of these stories that we've been hearing. Out of 890 environmental sector ministries, 12% are women. Women make up less than a quarter, 24%, of leadership positions on major climate finance mechanisms, and only 7% of women are finance ministers around the world. So that's just 14 out of 193. 10.6 ministers in energy sector ministries are women, and just 18% of World Energy Council secretaries are women. So we see that across the board in these really important decision-making and leadership roles, women are underrepresented. But hope is not all lost. we've also been looking more recently at INDCs, Intended Nationally Determined Contributions, that came out of this last Paris climate change meeting. And what we found is that 40% of INDCs as of April mention women or gender. We've also been looking at energy, national energy policies and documents. I think we're going to be hearing a lot more today from my panelists about energy and clean cook stoves and things like that. And so we analyzed 195 documents, and approximately one-third contain some of the keywords that reference women and gender. And what's really great about this information is that we hear often the 1.2 billion people that do not have access to electricity. What we don't talk about as much is that 95% of these 1.2 billion people live in sub-Saharan Africa and Asia. And what was great in this policy analysis of these energy documents is that both sub-Saharan Africa and Asia are above the global average. So we see there's really traction there. And so the title of this panel is Climate Champions, Women Entrepreneurs, and Climate Solutions. And so I'm really excited to talk about how we are moving, how the paradigm is shifting, how we can empower women to be agents of change and climate champions. And so I am joined by four panelists here, and I'll let them introduce themselves further as they come up. But we have Maxine Burkett from the University of Hawaii, Matthew Edwardson from Tetra Tech, Neha Misra from Solar Sister, and Stevie Valdez from the Global Alliance for Clean Cook Stoves. And I'm really excited for that, to hear them share some of their perspectives on these issues as well. And I guess we'll just go in order of seating. So Stevie, do you want to start?
First of all, I just want to thank you, Maggie, for that warm introduction, and thank you to the Wilson Center for inviting the Global Alliance for Clean Cook Stoves and for inviting me to come and speak today on this. My title is the Manager of Impact Investing and Market Development, and you'll notice that that does not involve climate or gender whatsoever. I am neither a climate nor a gender expert, but I am a private sector development expert. I am trying to get investment into our sector, and that's what I work with every day. I work with the entrepreneurs who are behind the change that are trying to mitigate some of the terrible effects that we see from cooking on solid fuels over rudimentary stoves and open fires. So I'll talk to you for a couple minutes today just about the issue. I think you heard a bit from Sarah in Kenya, who can tell it much better than I can. But to bring that back up to the macro level, before I talk about how we are actually taking this from a gendered perspective and a business perspective to make sure that women are actually at the forefront of making this change. We've really talked today, I heard some language around including women or the solution targeting women, but actually the solution being driven by women at every single level. So not just woman as the end user or woman as a value chain participant, but woman as the CEO of the company that's going to make a difference in this world. So that's what I hope to give you in 4 minutes or less, but we'll see how it goes from there. And while they're getting the slides up, I'll maybe correct a couple of the data points. So for those of you who heard from Julia Roberts that talked about the issue of clean cooking, dirty cooking over rudimentary stoves affects 3 billion people globally. That's more than the general energy access issue. That's 40% of the world's population. 4.2 million people, we now know, die every year from cooking over solid fuels. That's more than AIDS, malaria, and tuberculosis combined. This is particularly a sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia issue, though it's also an issue in Latin America. And it's not just the health issue. We know this disproportionately affects women and men. But bringing it back to the climate issue, 25% of black carbon emissions globally come from the household level, from household use of solid fuels. So you have a short-lived climate pollutant, something that has a short atmospheric lifestyle, which means it's our best chance at quick mitigation if we start to look at black carbon as a solution, or reducing black carbon as a solution. And 25% of that coming from cook stoves and fuels is a really good place to start. In addition, about up to one-third of your ambient air pollution in South and East Asia, for an example, comes from the household air pollution from lighting and cooking. So that's a bit of the issue. And why does the Global Alliance for Clean Cookstoves exist? If you've been in development forever, since the 1980s, you've probably heard about cookstoves, and you probably have this idea of not another cookstove. Mm-hmm. Well, the Global Alliance for Clean Cookstoves, I don't know if anybody plays Jada-Date around here, but if you heard of the Global Alliance for Clean Cookstoves, we were launched in 2010 to create a market-based solution, a global thriving market for clean cookstoves and fuels. And we have this four-pronged mission going back to our cross-cutting impacts of cooking around saving lives, improving livelihoods, empowering women, and protecting the environment. But women has actually been at the central piece of our central part of what we do from the very beginning. So going to how women were involved, I'll bring it back to an entrepreneur I met when I first started with the Global Alliance for Clean Cookstoves about 3.5 years ago. He was a male CEO, and he said, well, of course I'm having an impact on women. Women use my product. It's not pervasive of the entire cook stoves and fuel sector, but it's definitely an attitude that we've been working to change from the very beginning. And mainstreaming gender and how we approach the issue of clean cooking and using and making sure that women are actually the solution is a big part of what we do. But we find four key barriers to that when we went to go look at how are we going to create a market for cook stoves and fuels. That's capacity. Capacity and gender mainstreaming. Our entrepreneurs and 95 to 99% of the CEOs of our companies, to be honest with you, are male. And it's fascinating to me how we don't have more women involved in leadership of major cook stove and fuel companies. But capacity to gender mainstream and involve women at the very beginning is an issue. Financing, obviously. Financing for women and financing for better gender mainstreaming within your business or your NGO that's trying to implement cook stoves and looking at this from a gendered perspective. Evidence, so a big gap in understanding how gender mainstreaming, again, women at the end user level, but actually how you're changing your program strategy to better include a gendered aspect for adoption is a huge issue. And then finally, the policy and advocacy. And how we've really been addressing this is through each one of those things, including and starting with research. So we have some research out of Johns Hopkins University that tells us that if we give women agency-based empowerment training at the micro-entrepreneur level, they outsell their male counterparts for cook stoves and fuel solution 3 times to 1. Their customers report better usage rates, better adoption, and better satisfaction with their technologies than the ones that were sold by male entrepreneurs. So we know that it's not just convincing a woman in a household that she's cooking wrong and that she needs to adopt a clean cook stove, is having a woman being involved in creating that change within her community and talking to other women about cook stoves and fuels. It's also involving that woman in the design process of how the technology has worked. It's involving women in the manufacture of cook stoves and fuels. our male CEOs will tell us that they want more and more women employees because the women employees will really not only be champions for their product, but they are there, they're showing up, they're working, they're incredibly productive, and they give incredible feedback on how their business operates. So we are at time, but I'll just sort of leave you with one of the ways that we've really injected some financing into this sector, and you'll hear from Neha Mizra from Solar Sister, who's a partner. Lucy is a customer of the Paradigm Project who received Women's Empowerment funding. Women's Empowerment Fund has instructed the Paradigm Project and allowed them to recruit micro entrepreneurs, women. Lucy bought her cook stove from a Paradigm Project entrepreneur. She was educated on how to use it. She was given a warranty program. She knows who to call when that cook stove is no longer able to be used or broken. And then she's now able to save up to $200 a year on her meager salary on charcoal use. The Paradigm Project reports 85% of their cook stoves sold come from women. Their women sell 2.65 times more than their men. And these women have actually been instrumental in creating changing consumer financing programs. So the women entrepreneurs will actually go and create Chama groups just so women can access these technologies that wouldn't typically have access to them before. So they're at the center of this, and I hope that we can talk a bit more about all the dynamics involved. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thanks so much. It's good to be here. I am Maxine Burkett. I'm a professor of law at the University of Hawaii. I'm also a public policy fellow here at the Wilson Center for the summer. My primary area of research is actually climate-induced migration and displacement, but that's not what I'll be talking with you about today. I'm happy to take any questions about that during Q&A. We'll depart a little bit from the topic of the panel, but I'm happy to do it. But what I'm doing now is a little bit more relevant to what we're supposed to be talking about. And I'm doing this in my capacity as the vice chair of the board of the Global Green Grants Fund. The Global Green Grants Fund is a 501c3 public charity, and our mission is to mobilize the on-the-ground resources to fight environmental degradation, promote sustainability, and support social justice around the world. And our vehicle is microgranting. We think that that is a more transformative way of funding community groups, small community groups, and a number of which are led by women and benefit women. And we identify and support these community groups with regional advisors. We're a leading funder. Environmental funder in grassroots action on the global scale, and we've directed about $45 million in grants to grassroots initiatives in 165 countries. We have a gender and environment initiative that came out of a recognition that women are more than half of the world's population, but many do not receive support for their environmental leadership. And that leadership is unique, it's innovative, and it often comes at great risk, as we've seen from actually recent media and recent occurrences with respect to the risks that environmental leaders, and particularly women, face when trying to defend their rights. Now, in terms of a story, I wanted to sort of frame this around Mama Aleta. Mama Aleta was one of our grantees. She said regarding the forests that sustain her, "My people regard the earth as the human body. Stone is our bone. Water is our blood, land is our flesh, forests are our hair. If one of them is taken away, we are paralyzed." And deforestation is an issue throughout the globe. It occurs as a result of activities such as mining, accounts for 1/6 of the global carbon emissions, making forest protection a critical strategy for climate change mitigation as well as adaptation. And we see that when there is impact on these forests, the impacts are devastating, obviously, globally. They're devastating as well to indigenous communities that rely on them and that whose survival is inextricably linked to their sacred natural resources. Over the last two decades, Mama Aleta has led her community in saving approximately 40,000 acres of forest and preventing thousands of tons of carbon from being released into the atmosphere. And so, to underscore the impacts of the model that I'm describing, a microgrant in 2009, a small grant through the Samdana Institute, allowed for this indigenous organization that Mama Aleta and other community members formed to hold a regional assembly. And in that assembly, three local tribes attended, joined together, formed a renewed front against the mining interests that were behind the deforestation they were experiencing, and they decided that women should be at the forefront of the protests, and consequently, 150 women occupied the local mining site for a year, and they staged a weave-in. for that year, weaving their traditional cloth in protest while men brought them food and took over other domestic duties. For her sustained efforts in defense of the environment, Mama Leta won the Goldman Environmental Prize in 2013. And she and her organization are also now creating economic opportunities for the villagers through sustainable farming and other enterprises, including selling those traditional cloths from weaving. These stories are legion, and in fact, we, as part of the Gender and Environment Initiative of the Global Green Grants Fund, we recognize that women's rights and climate change are inextricably linked, and Green Grants, alongside International Network of Women's Funds, brought funders and activists from the women's rights and environmental movements together to gain a deeper understanding of the intersections and the needs of grassroots women on the front lines of climate change. It was in August of 2014. We co-hosted, it was an international summit in Indonesia, and it brought together nearly 100 representatives from environmental and women's funds, grassroots women's leaders, women leaders, and other funders. 37 countries were represented, and we shared strategies that grassroots women are using to combat climate change in their communities. We address challenges such as criminalization and violence against women climate leaders, and we strategize ways to engage foundations, corporations, governments, international financial institutions, and others around supporting grassroots women's climate solutions in the Global South. We also learned a lot of new and interesting things that I think are relevant to our conversation. The key finding is that less than 0.01% of worldwide private grants fund projects at the intersection of women and climate change. There's a huge gap in funding for grassroots women fighting climate change in the Global South, and Green Grants and INWF members are some of the few that do, but again, it's obviously quite a small proportion. Of the total number of environmental projects that Global Green Grants supports, almost half included issues of women's rights. Of the women's funders, funds around the world that supports women's rights, such as gender-based violence, half of the projects overlapped with the environment, something that the women's funds themselves had barely noticed. There are other striking findings that I cannot tell you because I'm out of time, but I will say but I'm happy to sort of let the secret out during the Q&A. But I will say that in closing, and so from what we learned from Mama Leta's story, for example, is that sometimes the best technologies are the lowest tech technologies, if you will. The new technologies, the large-scale projects are very important, but women like Mama Leta are leading grassroots climate initiatives that are both informed by the local community, serve as large-scale climate change mitigation strategies. And what we saw was that preserving the forests in West Timor, where Mama Leta lives, protects the livelihoods of the women who weave with the products and dies from the forest, and the food and fuel local communities depend on to survive. Preserving those forests will also curb, as I mentioned, tens of thousands of tons of carbon from being released into the air and serve as key climate mitigation strategies for local communities. Food for thought. Thank you. Womenandclimate.org if you're interested.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Maggie. Thank you, panel participants. And thanks to all of you for sticking it out and still being here. Getting towards the end, and just want to quickly introduce myself. I'm Matthew Edwardson. I'm the Sector Director for our Environment and Natural Resource Practice at Tetra Tech. We're a global consulting firm, and we implement hundreds of projects worldwide. And I'm going to drill down a little on some of our projects in the environment and agricultural space that we're implementing primarily on behalf of USAID around the world. Behind me, I have a slide of a consultation process that's happening in Uganda. And this was done through a program that we worked with through USAID called the African and Latin American Resilience to Climate Change Program. What we did on this project was something that I've heard spoken of a lot today, and it was really like help develop methodologies, help develop data sets, understand the research to really grasp, what does this mean, vulnerability to climate change? So with a number of colleagues at USAID and working in missions around the world, we we kept going through these methodologies, and we put forth a methodology for climate change vulnerability assessments that really looked at the exposure that individuals, be it at a community level, at a larger national level, may have to climate change, their sensitivity to that exposure, and I've heard it mentioned earlier, what their adaptive capacity is, and then based upon those findings, which were very rigorously obtained and analyzed, we would have an options analysis, and we would really think about how can we put forward some options for the local communities, for the national policymakers to actually undertake steps which will allow these target communities, at whatever scale it may be, to really implement adaptive activities so that they can improve their resilience to climate change. And the quote above kind of illustrates how that process, you know, I think very importantly, was able to change the minds of some of the more skeptical individuals and really provide good context to move forward with policy actions. Drilling down a little, and we're going to just kind of move through the case study idea of looking at, you know, microcosms of what's happening, picking up on the two previous presentations. We have some women that we're working with in India here, and what they're doing is they're picking a non-timber forest product that is used to treat liver ailments. And what we've done on this project is really worked on understanding how we can do two things, and this was mentioned earlier. You know, one is really like help women become, you know, viable entrepreneurs, like really help them develop, help them gain income so that they can be making important decisions for their households, that they can decide where their money is going to be spent, they can buy food, they can pay for education, they can really be self-empowered. And through this process, we're working on improving their livelihoods, but we're also working on improving the management of a natural resource base by really encouraging the development of this non-timber forest product. They are not only picking these products, but they're also propagating them in the forest, which is increasing the value of that forest. It's raising the awareness, and it's improving the chances that that forest will be conserved and this livelihood will be protected. This is part of a project that is working on a part of, as a climate change mitigation program. So the end of game here is not just the propagation and the sale of these non-timber forest products, but it's also the sale of carbon credits for the conservation of that forest. So there's multiple strategies that we're trying to achieve in this process. Here we have Leticia. She's a very dynamic woman entrepreneur. She's from Uganda, a couple hours outside of Kampala. And here you see a picture of her in her shop. You know, she's an entrepreneur. She's selling climate resilient products, seeds and organic agricultural inputs. She's also an agricultural extension agent. You know, she doesn't just sell these products. She goes out and she teaches farmers how to use them. And she's a head of a household. She's also the only entrepreneur in this town who's a woman who owns her own shop. And all of this is happening, you know, within the larger context of climate change adaptation and, you know, improving resilience. She's selling products which are drought resistant. She's providing agricultural inputs which will promote environmental sustainability. It's an exciting story. She's an exciting community leader, and our project is just giving her a few more tools in her toolkit, business development and other types of things. She's got a timer, I've got a timer, and they're all telling me to hurry up. Last slide. So I'll just quickly close with a short little statement of, I think that CCVA process, that vulnerability assessment process, but this is it being implemented on the ground in Indonesia. We've been working with women who manage different types of horticultural projects outside of protected areas in Aceh. And we, through that process, we identified the issues that were affecting them, such as drought. And what we really tried to do was promote diversification of their income so that they were not as sensitive to climate change. And so here she's growing some eggplants. She's also started to promote several other products. And so she's really diversifying her income base so that she and her family are more resilient to climate change as it will occur in the future in you know, her hometown and the hometowns of you know, many individuals throughout the world. Thanks.
Great. It's a race against time. That's all symbolic and literal both. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Neha Misra. I am the co-founder and chief collaboration officer of Solar Sister. I'm in the business of light, hope, and opportunity. I am here to share with you that women entrepreneurs advancing climate solutions are not unicorns. We exist. I believe in unicorns, but we exist in reality. We are doing the work. We are making it happen every single day. And it's happening right now as I speak. I want to focus my brief time-bound comments on solutions, which is really what Solar Sister is about, right from our woman-led board to our woman-led founding team, to really dynamic country leaders that we work with in sub-Saharan Africa, who are women champions at the forefront of climate change solutions, to thousands and thousands of Solar Sister entrepreneurs who are really bringing a change and bringing clean energy solutions and building resilience right there in their communities. So what we do is two things. One, we address the gap in geographical access. How do we take clean energy to those who are most underserved, who are most vulnerable to the impacts of climate change? There was a discussion in an earlier panel on people not knowing the language of climate change, the syntax of climate change, but they live it. You don't need to know the language, but they experience it. They might not know our words, but they know what's happening, and something is happening dramatically, and sometimes not so dramatically, but it's happening, you know, at different paces in different parts of the world. And more often than not, in many of the communities we work in, it is dramatic. So one is, how do we address the geographical access gap? And we do so by very deliberately being focused on last mile access to clean energy. Second challenge is, how do you address the cultural access barrier? How do you become intentional about including women in the clean energy value chains? And what this panel is about, not as victims, but as game changers, as champions. So what we do at Solar Sister is we recruit, train, and support women as clean energy entrepreneurs. We give them tools they need, a business in a bag, and training and support, access to world-class products delivered at their doorsteps in villages across sub-Saharan Africa, so they can bring clean energy and trusted customer care to their neighbors and to the savings associations they are part of, to the village markets that they go to. We started in 2010. Since then, we have built a network of 2,500 Solar Sister entrepreneurs in Uganda, in Tanzania, in Nigeria. Our goal is by 2020 to double our entrepreneur network from 2,500 to 5,000 and to 10x, 10 times. Grow our customer base. So clearly we have a big task ahead, and if you want to work with us, come talk to me afterwards. Last week we released a really important report done by the International Center for Research on Women, which assessed what our impact is at the intersection of climate change solutions and women's entrepreneurship. We wanted an independent voice to speak to what we believe firmly in, which is also unicorns that I spoke about, but that we are really making it happen. And if you're interested, go to our website, solarsister.org. It's on the homepage assessment, you'll find it. They found that Solar Sister's model is empowering women, increasing women's income, and making communities safer. What does safety mean? Safety has many nuances of meaning. Safety means women are financially independent, so their husbands and their children, they respect them more. Safety means when they are going out at night to use the outdoor toilet, they are safer. Safety means when they are going to chop wood, we spoke about gender-based violence, they are not going that long distance every second day. So there are so many dimensions to safety. And some of the photos you see here is Juliet Mulel. She's a 61-year-old Maasai woman from Tanzania. Before she became Solar Sister, before she heard about Solar Sister, she was using her three-stone fire cook stove. She had severe chest pain. She became a Solar Sister entrepreneur. It started by becoming a user herself. She's using a cook stove. She is using a solar light, which really helped her chest pain go away. And she doesn't have itchy eyes now. She's using the income that she's earning to pay for her four grandchildren's school fees. And you would have seen a photo of her with a little girl. That's one of her granddaughter, Rita, who has now graduated from primary school. And her neighbor is buying from her. Why women as sellers? Because her neighbor trusts her than a fly-by-the-night seller who she will not know. If something happens, where should I go? How do we bring behavior change when a technology is new? And often behavior change comes when you see somebody you know and trust really using a product. And just a few more stories, and there are many, many, many of those. We have a solar sister entrepreneur, Petronella, in Tanzania as well. She has a customer who's a cotton farmer. And she shared that before she got a solar lamp from a solar sister entrepreneur, she was using kerosene, and she was really scared when she would harvest her cotton that it might all get burned because fire is a big hazard. And now that she has a solar light, she is confident and she's increasing her income. We have basket weavers who are working longer into the night. We have midwives and nurses who are now able to deliver children under bright solar light instead of helping with really difficult deliveries in dismal darkness. And finally, I want to share with you the story of the entrepreneur you see here. Her name is Fatma. She's also from Tanzania. She loves us so much, she has named her new cow a solar sister. And here you see she uses her solar light to protect her herd from hyena attacks at night. And earlier she was waking up many times at the night to check on the cows. She also shared with us that earlier, every single day, she was chopping wood to cook, and now the same load of wood lasts her 3 weeks. And the time that she has saved, she's using to grow her business. She's taking care of her children's education. And these are her words, not mine. She says her husband loves her more because she has more time and she's making more money. So I just want to end on, you know, these are just few of the really, really powerful stories. We need to make change happen at all levels. Like I said, from boardroom to the villages, what can we do? What can we do now? Whether it's financing or partnerships, PCI is here. We are collaborating with their WE groups that we earlier heard about in the panel before us. We are partnering with the Global Alliance for Clean Cook Stoves, and I see a lot of familiar, friendly faces here. So I would just say that woman energy and climate change is not just about woman energy and climate change. It's about sustainable development goals, everything, the whole nine yards. So be a part of the solution, and I hope we can share a bit more. Thank you.
Thank you, Neha, and thank you all of the panelists for sticking to that really short time constraint. And I know all of you have so many more interesting anecdotes to share. And Neha, I just want to say thanks for mentioning the SDGs. One of the things that we talk about at IUCN when we look at the SDGs and all 17 of them and across all of them is that you can't achieve any of those SDGs. We will not achieve any of those SDGs without achieving SDG 5, which is gender equality. Because if we achieve them without achieving gender equality, we achieve them without half the population. So I think that's a really important point. Wow, we heard a lot of really great ideas and themes. I have a couple things highlighted in my notes, just market-based solutions, financing for women, and specifically micro-granting. We've talked about all day today how women's rights and climate change are inextricably linked. We heard about vulnerability to climate change, but also resilience, women entrepreneurs and action within the context of adaptation to climate change. And then, of course, the cross-cutting theme, solutions driven by and led by women. And I'm sure all of you have a lot of questions. This is such a great panel. And before I open up the floor, I just have a couple questions for each of the panelists. And Steve, I'll start with you here. And I'm going to play devil's advocate for a minute. And I'm going to ask you, you talked about investing in women and market-based solutions. And so I'm going to ask you, why should we invest in women? Why not just people? Or, you know, why not people that are, you know, on the front lines of climate change? Why women specifically?
I think that goes back to some of the evidence we've started to collect, and we definitely need more evidence. And if you have things to share, please come up to me afterwards or share them during the Q&A. But, you know, the one study I just cited in my previous comments of the randomized control trial with Johns Hopkins University was fantastic. If we just invest in agency-based empowerment training for women sales agents, that actually increases the top line of the companies or the revenue-generating NGOs or social enterprises, and it increases adoption. It's a simple calculation, and we're still trying to figure out some of the additional research, but I manage a larger grant program that's meant to scale up enterprises in our sector called the Spark Fund, and it's also meant to attract private sector investment. And what we do with that fund is we conduct gender lens due diligence before we even put money into a company. Not to exclude a company, but to understand where is this company weak on investing in women within their internal operations, but also investing in gendered marketing strategies and other areas which we see as essential to their success as a business. So we'd like to see more evidence around gender mainstreaming having an impact on the private sector, and that's why the private sector should be putting their time and energy in this, particularly in climate change oriented businesses. But then also much more research on women and men at the leadership levels, which we have some in the traditional business world starting to come out about women on boards and things like that. But I think it's a common issue, not just in gender and the developing world in businesses, but it's actually an issue here with Fortune 500 companies in the United States. And I think it just seems like it's so easy and a simple question, but we don't have the research to convince the males that they should be investing in women. So how do we make that happen?
Yeah,
and so that's my,
we
have some of it, yeah. But I think that we're still trying to make that case, to be honest. Yeah.
Great, thank you. Maxine, I have two questions for you. One of them to your role with the Green Grants Fund, and then one of them to some of your other work with islands and coastal areas. So I'm interested to hear that statistic you shared with us about 0.01% of private grants going to women and climate change. Can you talk a little bit more about how the Green Grants Fund is working to address that, and also about how some of the best technologies are the lowest tech technologies, and kind of share some anecdotes? And then my other question for you is related to the coastal and islands perspective that you have. And I'm just wondering if you can talk a little bit about how climate change impacts women specifically in these contexts, because I know that I've heard that women in Pacific Islands are on the very front lines of climate change, and, you know, indigenous people as well. So if you could talk a little bit more about your work with that, that'd be great.
Sure. So there are sort of two different things there. I will first say that there's some literature outside that talks a lot more about the Women in Climate initiative that we had done at Global Green Grants Fund, and it's a part of the larger gender and environment initiative that we have launched to sort of get a better understanding of how we are giving in that area. And the Green Grants Fund recognized that, in fact, that we were giving in that area in the same way women's funds were giving in that area, but hadn't sort of tagged it so they could understand what the impact was and where the touch points were and how vulnerabilities revealed in those ways. And so we find that we are doing more funding in the area, but of course there's more that's needed. And what I have learned over my time with Green Grants is that there are a number of people who'd like to give in this way, but don't know how to. And there are a number of organizations that would like to sort of to have a moment where their activity is catalyzed by this kind of funding. But the funding that most private foundations give or philanthropy is used to giving is much larger than these organizations can absorb in place. So this notion of microgranting is meant to be more consistent with the kinds of activities and actions that can happen at the grassroots level that doesn't overwhelm the community itself. That doesn't, maybe they don't first, for example, have the capacity to take a $25,000 grant. So we're looking for really catalytic moments that we can sort of inject energy into and achieve different kinds of results. So when we think about women and climate change, there are a number of opportunities for that, and organizations like ours are trying to facilitate that for funders. And we created a full manual that describes how you can engage more effectively in that way. With respect to ocean and coastal and climate and islands and women, I have an entire course on that. Happy to distill the key points for you here, but I think we all need to get home tonight. So I will say this. I mean, one of the, and again, I'm going to use green grants. I mean, one of the transformative grants that we gave, and again, I think this is true from the grantee's perspective as well, and that's what's paramount, is the was for the Carteret Islanders, who are from Papua New Guinea and were having to essentially organize around their relocation from their atoll island to the mainland of Bougainville in PNG because of rising sea levels. And the leader that was identified was Ursula Rakova. She has been an incredible voice for women in her community, but certainly sort of globally when thinking about the displacement issue and when seas are rising and cultures are carved up, the concern about community staying together, the sort of larger family, the clan, staying together and relocating is significant. She was a leader in that way. We funded the opportunity for them to sort of plan around that. And there is a kickstart now for development, rather economic development, that will allow them to, in their new home, be able to be self-sufficient, given that there's a very different different requirements for sustaining livelihoods there. They cannot be fish and taro people, for example. They're going to be inland, and how do they do that? And we've worked with the community to help with that through Ursula's initiative and hard work. So
that's great. Thank you. Matthew, a question for you. You have a vast amount of experience leading and supervising international programs related to natural resource management. You talked a bit about the options analysis that has been done. And I'm just wondering, there are many of us that work on similar projects and that are really looking to empower women or to include gender equality in some of the indicators and the outcomes. And I'm just wondering if you can share with us a little bit about how you track success in relation to gender equality, or how you look at success, or how you monitor gender equality throughout some of these projects and these analyses.
Yeah, thanks for the question, and happy to talk about that a little bit. I mean, I think it really comes back to your point that you made on, you know, the sustainable development goals. Like, if we don't hit number five, we're not getting anywhere. And I think what we do on our projects is, we have results frameworks, we have indicators, we have targets, we have all of that. But before we can really start to understand how we can effectively implement a program to achieve those numbers that we will have, you know, put together through a number of different analyses, we will actually implement a gender strategy for the program. And through that strategy, we're gonna really consider, like, at every single intersection, you know, how will we ensure that, you know, all different types of individuals are included in this process, women, children, vulnerable populations, men, and not just look at it in a, you know, a very kind of like male-female, but really segment the populations, because there's huge differentiations, you know, between, you know, the vulnerability of women depending on how much, you know, income they have to get started with. And then so that we can achieve the results which we've committed to getting done and hopefully exceed them, we're gonna look at it in that regard. And then what we really try and do on all of our programs is really have an adaptive approach. So as we implement an activity, we will, you know, constantly be looking back. Like, we're checking in with our teams all the time on all of our projects to make sure that, you know, we're not overlooking stuff. And you know, USAID is really embracing this, you know, collaborating, learning, adapting approach. I mean, it's not lip service. It's something that we're all trying to do. We're all learning from each other. You know, we're really trying to change the way we implement these programs so that we just don't have some target, you know, 5 years from now and just, you know, go forth and not change. But if we're not getting there, like, why? You know, are we not really being gender inclusive? Is equality not really happening? And how do we change 6 months in, 1 year in? And these are dynamic, and these are open, transparent conversations. And I mean, I think that's really the key is, you know, understanding the strategy up front. How does gender, you know, relate to each target being met? And then really taking an adaptive approach mm-hmm. to implementation of the program and really changing as climate changes and other factors change to make sure that you get to where you need to be at the end of the day.
Great, thank you. And Neha, can you talk a little bit about how access to energy can unlock further opportunities for women, and also specifically, why are women such effective salespeople when it comes to Solar Sister?
Why not? We are so good at word of mouth marketing. Ask all my friends. I would say one, we are dealing with technology. So trust is so important, as I mentioned. And sisterhood is so important. We did a year of end survey with 600 of our entrepreneurs last December to find out what is it that women value for being a Solar Sister entrepreneur. Number one was, yes, income generation opportunity. But that was not all. They value access to world-class products. They value somebody not cheating them. We all value that, I guess. We can agree. And they value there being warranties which are not dead or defunct, but warranties which are kept. Again, about trust. They value, this is something I think so important in our work, sisterhood. We spoke about agency earlier. What does it mean for a woman? We do a module called Dreamweaver, where we help the woman identify what are their dreams for themselves. Do they want to pay school fee? Do they want to buy sugar? Do they want to buy two more pigs? And I was talking to some of our entrepreneurs in Uganda last November, and I asked them, what do you like most about our training? She said, I love Dreamweaver because nobody had asked me in my whole lifetime before, what is your dream? So I think it's important, how can we use, again, going away from victimhood to how do we build an aspiration? We are building an aspirational brand of light, hope, and opportunity. We are not talking about darkness, which is the other side of it, but how do we create a way to the future? And likewise, I think in the climate change dialogue, how do we move away from fear? Fear can, be also a big driving force in a different way, but I think fear is negative. Action and opportunity is positive. And how do we really show that to women? And what we have seen from countless of our entrepreneurs is they are trusted. They help each other gain confidence. We have a staff who said she got up on a roof in a village to install a solar system, and people came and started looking, and they said, are you sure you are a woman? Because you're like installing a solar system. She said, I'm a woman, all right. And after 2 months, she said, their system is working really great, and they really respect me. And we have entrepreneurs who say, as they're passing through the village, the people shout out, solar mamas. So I think that respect, status, confidence, and being there, I think that's why women are so great. They are not looking for just moving away. There are a lot of woman-headed childhoods, women and child-headed households in some of the communities that we work with, and they are there. Men migrate, And there is a big sense of sisterhood and resilience that we saw in some of the videos earlier also, where the woman was talking about how her husband was relaxing. I have a great husband for record, but I think it's important. And I think Stevie was saying, we have increasing amount of evidence. We are building it, but it's not enough. People still ask me, Neha, are you a women's organization? Are you an energy organization? And I say, we are both, And some of you who might have heard me speak before, people also ask me, can you be a woman in tech with a flower in your head? Yes, you can. You can be both. You can be you can lead an organization of 60 staff in 4 countries in 5 years, growing your revenue 10 times, which is still a drop in the ocean. So I think those are some of our compelling arguments.
Like you said, women are making it happen every single day, and you are one of those women. In the limited time we have left, I want to open up the floor for questions. Please state your name and your organization or affiliation, and we'll take questions. I see a couple over here.
Sure. I'm Vic. I'm with the USDA Agricultural Research Services, and I was actually wanting to talk about the fact that like some of these videos and things have like a feel good feeling, like they have a feeling that like something's being done. But the other side of it is like we're kind of giving people tools to cope. And like these like women have been like resisting for generations. But I was also wondering about the fact that we're kind of giving, it's like out of necessity that they need to be resilient and not kind of talking about, like on the other side of it, our own economic and environmental exploitation. Even like when we were talking about like the ones that are hit hardest are women, and particularly like Pacific Islanders and people living on low-lying islands that aren't the contributors to climate change, and we are, the industrialized nations. And then we're also in a position to put like sometimes technocratic things versus like low-tech solutions. And so I'm really needing like some dialogue about the other side of this, about like our contributions to emissions, and you were mentioning like how the U.S. has contributed to the takedown of some indigenous like environmental activists like Berta Garcetas. So I'm at this like cognitive dissonance place where I'm like feeling this, but I'm also remembering like the other side of this, mm-hmm. that it almost feels like we're accepting that something's going to happen to those people and we're just going to do what we can to help them cope.
Wants to address that one first.
I can take a shot if I understood it correctly. Because energy justice and climate justice is a big driving force for me, because I grew up in Delhi, and I grew up in an upper middle class India, but I have, that was a transformational point for me when I worked in communities which had never had electricity. And US has been my home for last decade. And I do think there's much more we need to do. Are we not owning that? It's not a plain black or white answer. We work with State Department through a program called W Power Initiative, which is to advance women's leadership in clean energy sector. Can there be more of it? Yes. Should there be more of it? Yes. We are celebrating the success of Paris deal, but you know, you spoke about finance. Where is the money? I haven't seen it. So success would be when we see, and our very unique example and personal example, when we have the capital to grow our business, when we have capital for our entrepreneurs to grow the business. So I think some is happening. It's not totally dismal, but I would say you need to have a deep reserve of resilience yourself to work in this sector. You know, so, I've kind of hit at some of the points you made, but anybody else?
Yeah, I can add to that. I completely understand your concern and your frustration and the dissonance you're describing. And the way I've thought about it, because obviously if you think about the 0.01% that's going to women in climate change, there's 99.99% that's going somewhere else, and the scales are really overwhelming. And a big part of this is a big part of what's framing my thoughts on this and my comfort level today is that ECSP just yesterday had a really fascinating conversation about human rights and the environment, and we were able to sort of tease out some of the pieces of this that are about the current state of affairs and how we kind of address those and dismantle them, or at least derive better solutions. And a couple of ways to think about women and climate change that we are sort of skipping the surface on is that as women become more engaged in the conversations and the decision making, the kinds of solutions that we seek will be more transformative and probably systems level. And that's going to be more impactful. The other thing is that this is a David and Goliath kind of affair, climate change. And that's true. And to actually understand the extent of it, we have to understand that's what we're dealing with. There is a Goliath out there. But I think there are many, many Davids. Mm-hmm. And that's the key to these conversations, is giving them voice and giving giving Davids and Denises. really highlighting that. And there's so many of us. It's going to be a diffuse, diverse kind of resistance and a crafting of new solutions. I love the notion of just focusing on light, hope, and opportunity, because we can make change when we have a vision, when we imagine our and love and embrace our unicorns. Yeah. So or your...
And I'd just like to add to that, too. I think that we're going to see a shift from a policy perspective. One of the things, one of the many things we do with our EGI at IUCN is we analyze policy for gender inclusion. And I think that we're going to start seeing, we are already seeing, that policies in developing countries are doing a much better job of focusing on the justice issue, of focusing on gender equality. And I think that we're going to start hearing about not just South-South learning, but South-North learning, where the developed countries, the industrialized countries, are going to be learning from the developing countries, because our aid organizations and, you know, our NGOs that are working on these things, they see the value. And I think there's going to be, I don't know, a trickle-up effect, if you might say. But I think we're really going to start seeing a shift, because we're already seeing these countries that are receiving aid from more industrialized countries valuing these issues. But we need to turn it back around. And if the industrialized countries are putting their money where their mouth is, then we're going to have to see it in action here as well. Hmm. And any other questions? One right in the middle back there.
Hi, thank you. My name is Merritt. I'm from the Kenya Center for Excellence, which focuses on girls' primary education in Kenya. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about fostering entrepreneurship in the next generation and what you see the role of children and especially girls to be in entrepreneurship.
Do you want? I can take that first, and I'm sure Neha and others have a lot to say on it. But we see girls and boys both as critical towards the adoption of any solution that would be mitigating or helping with resilience to climate change. A really good example is in Ghana. We've supported the Ghana Girl Guides to learn and integrate about clean cooking and efficient cooking into their education and the curriculum. We've also supported a number of schools around the globe in various places such as Haiti and Kenya to integrate clean cooking into the school system so that the mothers who are volunteering as they're required to volunteer and cook as part of their children attending school, they're learning about clean cooking as an issue. So I think schools are really a hotbed for that, but children in particular are really incredible. And we had a girl guide in Ghana speak at our forum. We had a whole forum on clean cooking we hold every 2 years, and was one of the most eloquent people I've ever seen speak about the issue of clean and efficient cooking and how it affects her personally. And I think if we are using our donor dollars effectively to make sure that we're reaching girls and women about this issue and about education and climate change, about whatever, whether it's clean cooking or solar lanterns or you know, population, we were talking about population earlier and family planning, it's going to be absolutely critical. And we've seen phenomenal impacts. In fact, our director for gender and humanitarian programming, who couldn't be here today, is in Ghana looking at some of the impacts of that program. We're seeing incredible results from it.
I'll just say really brief in the interest of time. Role models, role models, role models. We have them. They're called solar sisters.
Okay, we have time for one more question. I saw a hand back there.
Hi, good afternoon. Sanola Daly from the Inter-American Investment Corporation. I'm really happy with this conversation on the private sector, because I feel like a lot of the time the conversation on climate change in itself alone is that relegated to NGOs and the government. Let them figure it out. So when you bring, you know, gender and climate change into the conversation, my question is, for the non-women entrepreneurs who are in this space, how do you, for the average agribusiness company or the average renewable energy company, get involved in women and climate change? What is the role of the rest of the private sector in this space? Thank you.
I can take that first, since I was speaking on that. It's absolutely crucial. So in addition to empowering women entrepreneurs, which we do through our Women's Empowerment Fund, I manage a larger fund, and we've been trying to also educate investors about gender mainstreaming. So you are going to have male-led companies, you know, CEOs, boards that have a majority of men on them. If you can change their practices so that they are doing business in a gender-informed way, the impacts are incredible. And so a good example of what we've been doing and engaging with our gender team is that gender lens due diligence that I mentioned. So we take a look at their HR, their marketing strategies. We take a look at the board makeup. And not just are women there, count, check, because that's, I mean, it's important to have that diversity and gender makeup on your team, but how are your messages tailored? How is your HR strategy tailored? How is what you're saying to women and men, particularly in the issue of clean cooking, is important because your message is different and both are involved in the household decision. If you don't score well on that for the gender lens due diligence, it's okay. If there's a red flag, we might not fund you, but we'll actually provide gender technical assistance in addition to our financing to the enterprises. So I will give you growth financing so you can build out your production facility or you can increase your distribution, but I will also provide you with a gender technical assistant that will usually create a gender action plan with you so that you are actually doing that in a way that either decreases your costs or increase your revenue. And a really good example, a Cambodian sustainable enterprise we worked with, a renewable fuel company, had an issue with female factory workers and their turnover. They were not showing up for some reason, and absenteeism was a huge issue, and yet women employees were some of his most effective employees. Our gender consultant took a look and tried to understand and separated out the women and the men employees on what they and why the women were not showing up, and it found out that the women were taking out incredibly high interest rate loans from local money lenders, and they would leave work and guaranteed payment later so that they can get payment that day in order to service their debt to the money lenders. So we were able to support their integration of financial management training and then microfinance loans to pay those off. Essentially, we're cutting the costs in the employee turnover for that company by taking a gendered look at what he or she is doing. And that's very micro level. But if you start to do that around the private sector globally and you start to include women in all of your climate change businesses from the marketing on down to the operations, I think that there's a real potential for global change. That's not just the developing world, that's here in the United States and Europe.
Thank you. And are you saying we like to say there is no justice in climate change? Nature does not choose its victims, we do. And we also know that women are disproportionately affected by climate change. But I think we've heard here today in this panel and other panels that women are also solutions holders and they are climate champions, and that we are not going to adapt and mitigate to climate change without them. Really quickly, can each of you give me one key takeaway for the audience, for people to take home with them from what you presented to us before we wrap up?
Start.
Yeah, maybe we'll start at the other end, put you on the spot, Neha.
Great. I would just say, you know, find a way to really support women entrepreneurs advancing climate change solutions. We need your support and partnerships, and support and partnerships come in many shape and form. So I'm still around. Talk to me.
No, there's been a lot of dynamic questions, and I guess what I was thinking about when hearing my colleagues' responses is that We have a huge amount of tools in our toolkit. I mean, there is a lot of proven strategies for economic development, you know, and, you know, women are so dynamic in the entrepreneurial sector and all the places that I've lived and worked and seen on projects and, you know, and even just the staff that we're hiring on some of our projects. I mean, I'm just blown away, you know, and, you know, a lot of them are women. Mm-hmm. You know, they are really just getting out, promoting new ideas, just different ways of thinking on some of these projects we have in Indonesia. Mm-hmm. And I guess kind of the comment earlier is like, there is a huge amount of hope out there. Mm-hmm. And we just need to empower people and provide the resources. And I think there's a lot of goodwill to make that happen. So mm-hmm. I think we just need to move forward in that regard.
I would say two things, if that's okay. One is, both very quick, but the first is that we want to be sure that the women that we're talking about, that we're supporting them, because in order to be transformative, there needs to be support there and not the additional burden of saving the world, which is sometimes the takeaway when we have these conversations about an intersection. So, okay, so I have to do that too, you know? So we want to be sure that we're not also saddling women, and that's an important takeaway. But I just wanted to also say that maybe because I'm in the classroom so much of my life, that I want young folks to come out of this conversation with not feeling despair, mm-hmm. And knowing that, so even from my vantage point, the next generation is just so profoundly intelligent and in a number of interesting ways about how to address these kinds of multi-layered kinds of crises that we're and opportunities that we're facing now. So I want to continue to sort of pound the hope.
Yeah, I guess I'll just close with that message of hope as well. And what I'd say, you know, dovetailing off of what Matthew said, there are solutions that are out there that are working, and they've all been sort of funded and developed and supported at small scale pilot levels. Like, it's time to put our resources where those successes are and to take them to the next level. And I think that there are a lot of decision makers in this room, in this city, in this country, and around the world that can help make that happen. And to put your resources where the proven approaches are working.
Great, thank you all.
Wow, thank you all so much. I just want to thank all of the panelists, particularly for, I know it was such a tight time frame. We could have, I think any one of them could have taught a course, as Maxine does, on these issues. And in fact, we think we could have had a 3 or 4 day conference on women and climate change. And if anybody wants to do that, I have a lot of notes, so you can have them. I'd like to introduce now Richard Parker, who is Project Concern International Vice President of Marketing and Communications, where he leads efforts to tell the story of PCI's work in 16 countries around the world. Richard?
Thank you, Megan. And as I'm the only thing between you and the beer and wine and cheese across the hall, we'll make this quick, I promise. But PCI is honored to sponsor this important conversation here today with our friends at the Wilson Center, with Tetra Tech, with USAID, and with the UN Foundation. And what a rich afternoon that we've had together. It's truly been that intellectual candy shop that you promised us earlier today, Roger, Mark, and I love that analogy, and I think it's so true. We've looked at three very distinct areas that demonstrate why women and girls are truly at the eye of the storm. We've looked at health, we've looked at crises, we've also looked at entrepreneurship. And I think the most memorable moments of the day for me are really the personal stories of impact that we have heard from. And I think we really started out with two very powerful women, with Sherry and Congresswoman Harmon as well. Sherry mentioned that we need to make climate victors and not climate victims, and to be able to tell those stories, and I think that really framed the afternoon very well. The Congresswoman reminded us that women are the last to leave catastrophes. They're always the ones that stay and continue to provide for their families, and they take a disproportionate share of climate change, as you just mentioned in the last panel. And that's something I think we have to keep in mind as we continue this conversation. The first panel I thought was terrific, so I loved Clive from USAID because I sort of share his trepidation of, as a man coming up and talking about women's empowerment and climate change. Then I think that he made some really important points, and it's great to see the priority that USAID is making in this effort, as well as all of the panelists in talking about this issue. I think the issue of urbanization was something that really resonated with me. I think if you think about all of the slides that we've seen this afternoon, really all of them were from rural areas. Whereas urbanization is going to be a huge component moving forward. By 2050, there will be the equivalent of 250 New York cities in the developing world. And that's something that we have to keep an eye on as people are going to cities looking for work, and they're settling in these, coming to informal settlements where there is no access to clean water, no access to health care, no access to education for kids. And these are the areas that are more prone to disasters, whether it be earthquakes or floods or tsunamis or cyclones or things that are happening in the developing world. So I'm very proud that PCI is actually taking a leadership role in this. It began after the earthquake in Haiti, really doing urban upgrading and making sure that we were rebuilding neighborhoods and not just houses. We were making sure that there were health centers, making sure that they would withstand the next earthquake, making sure that they had access to health care in these areas. And that's something that we're continuing to do, really partnering in Guatemala with many groups, and then also in Mexico, and we have a commitment through the Clinton Global Initiative as well to continue doing that. So that's going to be something that's really critical moving forward. And then here at home, I really appreciated Jackie from the NAACP and her presentation. and talking about gender-based violence here at home, which is something we really don't think about. If you her comment about Hurricane Katrina and the number of women that were raped during that, that's something I think that many Americans would be shocked by and that we all should be shocked by. And then from the last panel, it was wonderful to hear from Neha from Solar Sister, who is our partner in Tanzania, in making sure that we are encouraging women to really own their own businesses and selling climate smart tools there. And Stevie talking about selling clean cook stoves so that families can actually breathe easier. And I'm fascinated that women are, or I'm not surprised actually, that women are outselling the men 3-1. And that explains why I lose most every argument with my wife. So Suzanne from PAI started out earlier talking about, you know, what is your connecting story? And I think if we went around the room, all of us could talk about the stories that we have about why we're involved in this issue and why it's so important. And I have a couple pictures I will try to show. I'm technology deficient, I guess. Here we go. So for me, the moment really came in 2002. In the very early days of PEPFAR, I was working at HHS, and we were doing the initial assessments on the first 15 countries for the President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief. And this was on my first trip to Africa, and we were in Swaziland. We were visiting a remote hospital that had one physician, and he made house calls on AIDS patients because so many of the patients actually didn't have the money to be able to stay in the hospital. And this is well in the days before access to ARVs was so readily available through the support of the U.S. government. So we went on a house call with the doctor, and after driving down a very long road, we came to this little compound of four huts. And inside one of those huts on a mat was a woman dying in the final stages of AIDS. So the doctor checked her vitals. He left her with some porridge, some Vaseline, and really just made some notes about you know, what her status was. And that's really all that he could do. So outside of that hut, and you can see actually the effects of climate change even back then and just how dry everything was, but outside of that hut was her 9 children with her mother. And so this grandmother was going to be left to care for those children once their mother had passed away. Their father had, of course, left, as happened so often in the beginning of the AIDS epidemic, when the dads infected the moms and then just left. And what compounded the sadness even more and just really left utter hopelessness in my eyes was the effects of climate change. You know, there was a drought. All of the crops had failed. They were selling off their cattle. They had maybe 2 or 3 more animals. But then after they sold that last cattle, you know, what were they going to do for food? And it still haunts me to this day wondering, you know, what happened after they sold that last animal? What happened to the children when their mom probably died within days of the visit that we had with her? And while PEPFAR has made such a tremendous difference in Africa, saving the lives of millions, the effects of climate change were even in effect then, and it's the end of the story that I told. It still makes me wonder, you know, are we doing enough for climate change the way that we did with PEPFAR? And I think there's so much more that we can do. So I was in Malawi a couple of months ago, and just as El Nino is having a devastating effect in Ethiopia and in other countries, it's also doing that in southern Africa. So you can see how dry it is in some of those areas in Malawi. And as we discussed many times today, women are really the key to solving climate change, I think. And in Malawi, that's happening as well. And I am thrilled to hear that Joyce Banda is going to be joining the Wilson Center, because I think she's a great example as a former president of Malawi about women's empowerment. And this is really at the heart of every program that PCI has, as we work with families and communities to enhance health, end hunger, and overcome hardship around the world. So we know that women are the change makers, and our Women Empowered Initiative, or our WE program, includes almost 500,000 women in 12 countries around the world in small groups of 15 to 20 women, and they're really doing some amazing work. And so what I saw in Malawi were these women's groups that were coming together for seed fairs. They were branching out from the traditional crops that they have in Malawi, trying new ones that were more resilient to climate change, learning irrigation techniques, growing food for their families and communities in some of the most rural areas of the country. And as my colleague Kelly Fish had mentioned earlier today, we're piloting male engagement strategies later this year to involve husbands in the new and innovative ways to be able to produce food. And this is something we're seeing all across all of our countries, from Ethiopia to to Guatemala to India, where women are leading the way in our WE group, starting businesses, investing back in their communities, ensuring their children have nutritious meals and access to health care. They're becoming leaders in their communities and their countries, and the men are starting to take notice of this, respecting them, following them, and following them into entrepreneurship. So women are not just the eye of the storm, but I think they're also leading us out of that storm. And with a steady commitment to their families and communities and navigating climate change in their countries. So incredible things are happening, and I hope you're as encouraged as I am by some of the discussions that we've had today and to see what many people are doing around the world and how women are really leading the way. So thank you so much for being a part of this conversation today, and I hope we can continue it across the hall now as we have our reception, so I invite you to be able to go over there. So thank you and good evening to everyone.